Tennis elbow, also called as lateral epicondylitis, is a common condition. However, it is misunderstood and often wrong treatment is given. For that, we must know the natural history of the tennis elbow. It is a self-limiting disease. More than 90% of the patients recover completely within a year, and no one has it forever. So go on assuring the patient and giving non-operative treatment till it heals. Why non-operative treatment fails? For that, you know some facts about tennis elbow. Tennis elbow occurs due to repetitive mechanical overload, especially supination pronation, which causes micro tears of the muscles, extensor group of muscles, which results in inflammatory tissue around the elbow. The muscles involved are many. However, extensor carpi radialis long, radialis brevis is involved in 100% of the cases, extensor digitorum longus in 20% of the cases, epicondyle in 20%, intraarticular in 5%, and very important, it is associated with radial tunnel syndrome in 5% of the cases. So tests for tennis elbow are important. This is a resistant extension of the wrist, is called Cogan's test, and which gives pain at the epicondylar area. Tenderness is there over the epicondyle, 5 millimeters distal to the epicondyle, more distal to the epicondyle is the tenderness. Another important test, also called as Mills test, is extend the elbow, pronate the elbow, pronate the forearm, and give forceful flexion of the wrist, which causes pain at the elbow. Another test is Moseley's test, which is an a forcible extension of the middle finger, causes pain at the epicondylar area. So forget about the names of these. What is important is the extension of the elbow and pronation, flexion of the elbow, flexion of the wrist causes pain. Differential diagnosis is important. Perhaps the most commonly missed is the radial tunnel syndrome, which occurs in 5% of the tennis elbow cases. Osteochondritis dissecans of the capitulum, osteoarthritis of the radiocapitular joint, and posterolateral instability. These are all missed with the tennis elbow. Now it is important to know that radial tunnel tenderness occurs distal to the elbow crease as shown here, and the tennis elbow tenderness which is affects the posterior interosseous nerve, which is pressurized, and this is the arcade of are pressing on the posterior interosseous nerve, and this can be retract the muscles and you will get the posterior interosseous nerve as shown in this figure. Radiocapital arthrosis results in a narrowed joint of the radiocapitular joint and tenderness below the epicondyle. One must also distinguish between acute versus chronic tennis elbow. Acute results in tendinitis, is due to tendinitis, it is common, results in micro tear of the extensor carpi radialis brevis, resulting in inflammation, and the treatment is non-operative. Chronic epicondylitis or tennis elbow is rare. It is due to tendinosis, degenerative procedure, and there results in fibroblastic hyperplasia and the treatment always is operative. Non-operative treatment options are many, many, and on the net I found there are 35 different options. However, none of them is superior than any others. So currently, most of the centers give the non-operative treatment as I'm describing to you. 90% resolve spontaneously within 6 to 12 months. Therefore, give rest and ice pack to the area of epicondylitis and modify the activities of the patient. Avoid those activities which cause pain at the elbow. Compression strap is used. Injection, if these fail, then injection steroid and manipulation at the same time. Physical therapy, active resisted exercises and passive stretching. This is the non-operative treatment modalities followed in most of the centers and results in excellent results, and surgery is usually avoided. The exercises are wrist curls, that is, take a dumbbell of 2 kilo or 3.5 kilo or 4 kilo dumbbell and do flexion extension exercises of the wrist. This is the flexion extension exercises. And another important is passively flex the flexion of the wrist and then extend it passively and stretch it. So stretching the flexor muscle group of muscles, also the extensor group muscles, is important. Elbow compression strap. This is the elbow compression strap. Wear it for 3 to 6 months. And this should be applied. This is very important that this should be applied 4 centimeters away from the elbow crease. And use this during the working hours. And you can remove it when you are not working. Steroid injection, it is important to know that it gives good short-term relief only for 6 weeks. And you must inform the patient that this injection gives only for 6 weeks. And you may need after sometimes a second injection if there is more pain. But no more than 2 injections should be given. Now, what is important is when you give injection hydrocortisone, that time you also have given the local anesthesia. And make use of this local anesthesia to do a manipulation. The manipulation is just forcible flexion of the wrist, which results in inflammation and healing. Extracorporeal shock wave therapy has been tried, but very controversial and costly also, but its efficacy is not proved. But platelet PRP plasma, a platelet rich plasma, is a tested and time tested technique, and its application has been done in many centers. Just take 5 to 7 cc's of blood, inject in the canister and centrifuge, and you get the PRP layer, and take that layer and inject at the tender spot on the lateral epicondyle. Operative treatments are many: open debridement, percutaneous release, arthroscopic debridement, radial tunnel debridement if it is present. Radial tunnel also should be exposed and released. Now this is the incision that you take, 5 centimeter incision over the lateral epicondyle, and you will see the radial head and lateral epicondyle. And in size on the same, see, you will find that The extensor carpiradial is longus and extensor aponeurosis are covering the extensor carpiradialis brevis. As you open it, you will find the degenerated tissue of the extensor carpiradialis longus, and this needs to be excised. Once you excise that, you will find the radial epicondylar surface, and you debride that also by a periosteum and close the whatever the radial extensor carpiradialis brevis is closed to the surrounding tissues and reconstructed. So surgical tips are very important. Avoid damage to the lateral collateral ligament so that you should be away from it. Resect the degenerated tissue and address associated problems like radial tunnel syndrome, which occurs in 5% of the cases. If there is a Wolfer's elbow, you do at the same time Wolfer's elbow. If there is an intra-articular lesion is obviously seen, you can open the joint and do the needful. Results of surgery are very interesting. 97% of the cases, significant pain relief occurs. 90% of the patients, full return to sports. Sachin Tendulkar had tennis elbow surgery, and he was very much concerned about whether he is going back to his normal activity, and you know the results. Operative failures may occur in 2-3% of the cases. There are two types of failures. One is the recurrence of the symptoms. The same symptoms recur as previously. But then the second group is different symptoms occur, and that is also a failure. And this is due to inadequate release and incorrect initial diagnosis, usually missed, as I told you, the radial tunnel syndrome, most often missed. And you just, when there is a radial tunnel, associated radial tunnel syndrome, or per se without associated tennis elbow can be there radial tunnel syndrome. In both cases, it needs to be really the posterior intraosseous nerve needs to be released. Posterolateral instability can occur due to overzealous lateral collateral ligament release. And in such a situation, you have to do an arthrogram to see what is the cause of failure. This is by MOA. Percutaneous lateral release is also as effective as open release. You take a 10 cc syringe and 16 number large needle and insert under local anesthesia, insert the at the lateral epicondyle and just go on releasing over the lateral epicondyle on the surface of the lateral epicondyle. You just release the muscles, mostly extensor carpiradialis brevis is released, and then you just close it and you can inject hydrocortisone at the same time at the end of your surgery. And this gives excellent results. Inflammatory cascade is created, which results in healing. Advantages are, it is a very minimally invasive surgery, hardly takes 5 to 10 minutes. However, one disadvantage is, it does not remove the diseased, degenerated tendon of the extensor carpiradialis brevis. Arthroscopic debridement is also another method which is becoming more popular because it's a very non-invasive surgery and is only a small incision is taken. Management key points are, it is a self-limiting condition. 90% of the people are better off after 1 year. Physiotherapy, activity modification, and simple exercises like extension, flexion of the wrist will control the symptoms in most people. Also, you have to do a passive extension and passive flexion of the wrist Injections are reserved for very resistant cases, and an operation is only considered as a last resort. In my last few years, I have not done a single case of tennis elbow surgery, but most of them are with non-operative treatment, and in some cases, injection hydrocortisone gives good results. Thank you.